This is the expansion of the outer nebular radius. This is a dot, it is under the language driving over the line, is increasing with changing acceleration. So the outer angular radius in hydrodynamical models of that are shown there, the outer nebula radius is always increasing. And the nebula is always accelerated. With different speed, but it's always accelerated. So they didn't find the decelerations like that you have heard a few minutes ago. So that this kind of evolution is not confirmed by this spherically symmetric hydrodynamical models. How to estimate the true expansion velocity? Forgetting about the details of the expansion velocity field within the nebula, in the same group, analyzing the spherical symmetric model in the paper by Roman Corradi and Tal from the year 2007, they proposed to use so-called post-shock velocity as an approximation to the real nebular expansion, the general expansion velocity of the nebula. Here there's an extract from the paper. Here the emission profile of some line, and the line could not be. And they invented a method of having appropriately enough spectral resolution, you can compute the range over the velocity of this line flux. And so the flux increases, and then the slope is increasing, so we have the derivative as a maximum. And the very first maximum from outside is quite a nice proxy approximation to this post-shock velocity. Here they computed on a number of models this velocity, this post-shock velocity. Here on the middle shock they show a line which shows the ratio between this estimated from stellar emission profile velocity to the real expansion of planetary nebula, which means expansion of the nebular outer radius. And they obtained that correction by factor 1.2, 1.3 is pretty constant over quite long range of nebular ages. This method works quite well, but it works quite well if the nebula is totally ionized. It doesn't work so well, it doesn't work at all, when the nebula is the ionization bound. In the very recent paper of that group, they considered four different velocities of an expanding nebular shell, which should be taken into account when we are talking about expansion velocity. The propagation of the outer shock, this is the derivative of this outer radius over time, this the measure is really the true expansion of velocity of planetary nebula. The post-shock velocity is a thing that can be measured from spectroscopy, just like Romano Corradi in that paper shown. This is another possibility. Another possibility is measure the peak separation of Doppler's beta emission lines if you have enough spectral and spatial resolution. And if we don't have enough spatial and spectral resolution, we can always measure half width of emission lines. The last two points are contained in the tables like that of Weinberger's catalog. This is, I think, intriguing just right now. So during parallel to this hydrodynamical works, kinematical reconstruction used by models, so-called Taurin models, sometimes called, we produced and we checked what we can say with simple photoionization and kinematic reconstruction from models. Here there's a very simple example of one of our first papers in this series. When we show some very simple model, velocity is constant density at constant velocity of 40 km per second. And we show here that if we measure the separation of the peak, we always underestimate true expansion velocity, except for the cases when we have really very well resolved the nebula. So from this simple kinematical reconstruction, we follow clearly that the best thing to measure the expansion properties if we got is the half width at half maximum, except for the cases where we have very well resolved nebula. But this is a very simple example. More complicated situation comes when you want to come to real spectra. Real nebulae usually do not expand with constant velocity. Maybe I should be more precise. The constant velocity models do not reproduce the observed spectra. Here's some example from our work when we see the constant velocity model produce the same emission shape for hydrogen and for oxygen line. Computing making the model expansion velocity rising in the outer regions produce quite nice hydrogen lines. Some years later, collecting more observation with more different emission lines, we even found a situation that the models with so-called V-shaped velocity can reproduce pretty well observed emission profiles. Even if spectral resolution is good enough, we can detect a quite nice shape of the emission wings, we can find where the minimum of this V constituting emission expansion velocity can be, whether in outer mode or in outer region. This analysis can be done with this simple photoionization models. It's very fascinating. The problem, the complication is that the computed expansion of velocity, where the computed profile is depending on expansion velocity field and on density structure. So we can modify the profile, changing the velocity, but also changing the density structure. So here is an example from our paper when the same new shape of velocity field produced with different density structures, this or that produced differently, some better, some worse field at the emission time release. In the year 2003, we found that quite common is this new shape of velocity fields. Higher velocity near the outer edges and the higher velocity at the lower edges. At that time, it was not so much expected. Only later, the group of Detlef Schönberger, in a paper from 2004, they showed that really they found that the velocity is higher in the inner region, decreases and increases again towards the outer edge. So this is one of the successes of this simple models. And just at the beginning of thinking about the simple models, we were thinking about simple parameter that we can describe the velocity. And we invented so-called mass average velocity. The definition is not the same, the velocity field. From kinematical reconstruction, we have density field, velocity field, we can integrate them to produce a single number. I will call this the mass average velocity. It can be produced for any model obtained with any kinematical or really hydrodynamical models. Checking many different observations collected over years, we found that this parameter is quite a robust parameter. Even if we determine this from some earlier observation from a single emission line, and later, after a year, we collected more emission lines, adding more emission lines to the analysis improved the details of the velocity field, but doesn't change or change very little this mass average velocity field. So it seems to be quite well defined parameter. Recently, this year, this still unpublished result, we computed this mass average velocity for a number of models of different Detlef Schönberger. Also can be done. We have velocity structure, density structure, we can make this integration. And we made a division of the true expansion velocity derived from models by our mass average velocity and found well-definite ratio of 1.4 over a number of models, over a number of different ranges. So it seems to me still this mass average velocity is quite good parameters even when tested not only on different observations but on kinematical hydrodynamical models. This value of 1.4 is quite close to the 1.3, 1.4 derived earlier by Schönberger as a correction factor to expansion parallaxes, and it is also very close to the factor of 1.2, 1.3 derived by Corradi et al. In the year 2007. What else can be done in this area? Quite recently, Wolfgang Stephan et al. Produced 3D hydrodynamical velocity fields. They make nice hydrodynamical models, but without photoionization. But they show in these models that except of radial dependence on velocity, there also exists non-negligible poloidal velocity component. I forget toroidal, but poloidal velocity component is not dominant, but not non-negligible. This component indication deviation if you're from pure radial direction. They did then very clever the same thing. They obtained it, complicated the radial dependence on velocity. They to this field they applied 3D reconstruction with so-called homologous expansion. And then obtained some artifacts, which shows that we should be careful when we apply kinematical reconstruction with homologous expansion to the nebulae, which in fact do not expand homologously. So now I'm posing myself a question. How this effect may affect this spherical kinematic reconstruction? Probably it will, I don't know which rate and how much. And I wonder how this kind of this effects can affect mass averaging velocity. I think this will affect in this place, in kinematic reconstruction maybe quite a lot, but I still hope that mass average velocity will survive. But this has to be checked. So at the end, I think that now is the time, hearing to, during today, all the beautiful talks showing this radiation and 3D hydrodynamic density velocity structure, this complication. It's time to verify this one-dimensional kinematical reconstruction with the help of 3D hydrodynamic analysis, searching for possible artifacts that may start the discussion. I think it is now the time. So if some of you has the models, I can ask for a computer for trying to compare. Has the model, has the idea what is the age of the object model, can compute this mass average velocity energy. I think that mass average velocity is not a bad approximation to the global expansion properties. This can be used for deriving kinematical ages of planetary nebulae. This mass average velocity was verified on different observation data set, was verified on past tests using spherical hydrodynamical models. It could be worth to check the stability of three dimensional models. Okay.
I think that when you show that graphic when the velocity is going up, they only compute their models until 10,000 years, but after that they start in their models, the velocity starts dropping because the star goes down to the luminosity below the values of the luminosity. That's why I think you said that their models are always accelerating, but in their second paper they compute after 10,000 years and the velocity goes down. So that on your graphic is just going up, but after that.
So that was in agreement with the deceleration of planetary nebulae. Okay.
Yeah, because the velocity in flux is going down. So it's not that correct. The results of the curve of
I agree with you that mass average velocity is a good thing. I agree with you that when you call the mass average velocity is a good measure of expansion. Probably we call it an emission average velocity, and we always use the shell velocity that Corradini calls the post-shock velocity. That's more or less the same. And that's a good measure for the global expansion velocity.
I have a question. So, I mean, this simulations which are based on one-dimensional models can apply to long nebulae, which are very rare, maybe elliptic nebulae as well. But what about the majority of the expansion velocities in the equatorial plane, which is the right part, and which probably will contribute most to your long-dimensional results like spectroscopy? The kinematic age contribution that might be different or the same from what it could be from the material of the polar dimension. So I think these considerations are smaller regarding the fact that there is different, very different expansion velocities than the equatorial region of the polar dimension.
Well, certainly, yes, as well. These models. I don't mean the hydrodynamic model, but this kinematical reconstruction model goes to many from contemporary computers. This hydrodynamic model, who can tell you how long it takes to compute one hydrodynamic model with this SPH and radiation transfer and so on. So
Yeah, no, I understand. It's a difficult problem. I just want to point out.
So here, I can change a little bit the velocity field. This and that direction, which fits better to the emission lines. When people do carbon 1, carbon combination, obtain a velocity field after a couple of months combination, and they want to change the number a little bit and avoid that in the next month. So fast now that very soon we will be there will be available to such data in our abundance.
Any more? Thank you. We have the next speaker now, David Atramat, speaking about posting these stars and imaginary bodies.